So we are discussing the role and status of multinational corporation under international law. The point of crux is whether multinational corporations are subject of international law or not, or whether international law is competent enough to impose rights and duties on the multinational corporations. So we seen that though state is a primary subject, individuals are also having a major role to play in international law. They were recognized in several treaties, and even non-state actors like the multinational corporations are having rights and duties under international law. This subject we are discussing under four heads, that the four kind of different legislations are conferring rights and duties on international law. So first segment we seen, that is international investment law, wherein through the bilateral investment treaties between the multinational corporations and state, they are becoming the subject of international law, or not directly subject, but they are enjoying certain rights and duties under international law. Secondly, we say international human rights law, wherein the company, being a person, is entitled to security as well as the freedom of speech and expression, right to public hearing, fair trial under European Convention on Human Rights, under Universal Declaration on Human Rights, International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. We had also seen the cases under these conventions. Now we are at third segment, that is international environmental law. So whether international environmental law confers any rights and duties on the multinational corporations in the context of protecting environment while they function in particular country. One more important point we also discussed, that though international law confers rights and duties on multinational corporation, but practically it is the nation law within which that particular corporation is functioning, that law is directly binding on particular MNC. So ultimately the domestic legislation deals with the affairs of multinational corporations. Now we will see in what international environment conventions or environmental law is there recognizing this role and status of multinational corporations. So in the context of environment also, like investment and human right, here also multilateral environmental agreements are addressed primarily, and states and have at most indirect regulatory implications for multinational corporations. So in accordance with the fundamental principle, that is polluters pay principle, a few specialized agreements were established with civil liability rules for private actors which have the potential to cause particularly grave environment damage, such as oil spills or nuclear leakages. In short, the international law recognized the polluter pay principle. Polluter pay principles, one who pollutes the environment must have to restore the environment to its original position. This principle has been adopted by international law through several treaties, and the MNCs under polluter pay principle is having liability to pay for the act of polluting on behalf of them. So all of these instruments rely on domestic implementation and requires the contracting parties to establish the necessary enforcement mechanisms. So it is noteworthy that the international human rights law, self-regulation by companies through codes of conduct or certification system, examples are so-called eco labels, is more developed. So for this, as already discussed, we have Stockholm Declaration, then Rio de Janeiro Declaration, Nairobi Declarations, Declaration on Biodiversity Conventions, because of that CRZ rules were there. So these kind of international treaties, we can say, confers the obligations on multinational corporations, so they cannot pollute the environment in the country wherein they are working. And lastly, we will see international criminal law, whether international criminal law is binding or makes the provision for multinational corporations. So crime, we already seen at the first instance itself that human beings are the subject of crime. Now, corporations are abstract entity. They were created by law, and legal personality is conferred as distinct from the members of or shareholders, director, etc. of that particular company. They are different. This principle was recognized in Solomon versus Solomon case, that the company is having a distinct legal personality in the eyes of law. So company can be prosecuted or not. That's what international criminal law is. As per our Companies Act, company cannot be prosecuted for crime. But if there were instigations, abetment by the directors, the willful involvement of the directors, they can be prosecuted. But company can be held liable for civil actions only, or only civil liability can be imposed on companies. Therefore, in this context, the international criminal law does not and has never provided for jurisdiction over legal persons. Legal persons means person created by law, that is artificial, and others are natural persons. So already the first international criminal tribunal, the international military tribunal in Nuremberg, we already seen Nuremberg trial is a trial for war criminals. In that case, it was stated that it can exercise jurisdiction over individuals only. It famously held that crime against international law are committed by men and not by abstract entities, and only by punishing individuals who commit such crime can the provisions of international criminal law be enforced. So company is not an individual in the eyes of law. Company is a distinct personality. So company can be made liable for civil obligations only. So neither of the ad hoc international criminal tribunals, which are subsequently created by the United Nations Security Council, exercise jurisdiction over corporate entities. So there is a lacuna in national law as well as international law that corporations cannot be prosecuted for criminal wrongs. But nowadays, while drafting legislations, one provision is made that if the company commits any crime, the person who is in charge of that particular activity is to be prosecuted if he failed to prevent such crime from commission. So this new clause was there in recent legislations. So the 1998 draft statute of the International Criminal Court, on the other hand, provided that the court shall also have jurisdiction over legal persons with the exception of states. When the crime committed were committed on behalf of such legal persons or by their agencies or representatives. So here, the draft statute of International Criminal Court of 1998 had taken note of this fact that the legal persons can be prosecuted if the crime is committed by their representative. Therefore, company can be prosecuted for the crime committed by their representative, that is directors of the company. So directors can be prosecuted, though company cannot. So this approach was later abandoned, firstly, but this draft was not accepted. Now International Criminal Court is in existence, but this provision was not accepted because corporate criminal accountability is unknown to many domestic legal system, when which would have caused difficulties for the application of the complementary principle. So this concept was new to the world, the first thing. In no nation having the provision for prosecution of corporations, So this is the one reason to abandon that draft clause. And secondly, because some feared that state might be considered hypothetical if they establish criminal responsibility for every entity except for themselves. So state must have to be covered, otherwise state will become meaningless. So this clause was abandoned. So the extension of jurisdiction to corporate entities made it onto the agenda of 2010 Kampala Review Conference, which was held in Kampala, but received only limited attention due to the strong focus on the crime of aggression, because states focused on the crime of aggression. What aggression that is to be happening today with India, China, India, Pakistan. So there are, however, several domestic jurisdictions which recognizes the criminal liability of legal persons, among them Australia, Belgium, Canada, France, India up to certain extent, Japan, the Netherlands, Norway, South Africa, the United States and United Kingdom. These are the countries who are having provision under their laws for prosecution of the companies. For example, in India, the Environment Protection Act is there. As per this act, if the directors were held responsible for the criminal acts committed by the company, if that director failed to prevent that particular crime. So, on this line, certain number of legislations are there in India, because express clause is made, offenses by companies. If you look the modern legislations, one separate section was there, that is offenses by company. And in such section, it was generally drafted that person who is in charge of the company at the time when the crime was committed, and he is having knowledge that crime is committed, still he is not prevented or nothing has done on his part for the prevention of that crime. In such cases, there can be a prosecution of companies, and wherein punishment is to be executed on directors of the company. So, it is also noteworthy that several international instruments contain criminal liability provisions for legal persons. Legal persons means, please take a note of this, legal persons means person created by law. Suppose companies are persons created by law. Tomorrow, if the robotics industry is developed, the certain countries like North Korea today, they are conferring legal personality on the robots. Recently, you might have been read the news that one person approached to the Bombay Supreme Court and plead that the legal personality shall be granted to the animals. Animals should be treated like human beings. So he filed the petition. The petition was dismissed with cause, and court also stated, Chief Justice of India himself, that whether you possess all attributes of animal or whether animal possess all attributes of human being. So legal personality cannot be conferred on animal. That's what such legal personality, if conferred on the company, and that is conferred by Companies Act through incorporation, and company becomes legal person. That's what here, instead of MNC, we had used the word companies. So there were several international conventions dealing with criminal liability of legal persons, such as European Convention on Protection of the Environment through criminal law. Second is United Nations Convention Against Corruption, the United Nations Conventions on Suppression of the Financing of Terrorism, and the United Nations Convention Against Transnational Organized Crime. So in these conventions, there is a provision that even legal person, if involved, can be prosecuted. Then the question is, who is to be prosecuted? Whether a company can be put into jail? No, it is the director and the responsible persons of the company's affair. They can be prosecuted as per these clauses. So all of these conventions oblige the state parties to establish the liability of legal persons for the commission of crime as defined under respective instrument. Liabilities, however, never reduce to criminal liability alone, but leaves the member states to levy or to adopt administrative or civil measures in state. So they can adopt criminal as well as other administrative civil measures like closure of company from that particular nations, etc., disinvestment from that particular company, as well as prosecution of the directors of that particular company. So we can say, though multinational corporations are not exactly the subject of international law, but these four legislations covering the number of conventions recognize somewhere and somehow the role and status of multinational corporations under international law. So we can conclude this topic with saying that it has been seen in this contribution that on the one hand, MNCs can contribute to economic and technological development, increasing the wealth and the living conditions of society. Therefore, they merit protection against undue government interference and for the safeguarding of a stable and reliable business environment. But on the other hand, MNCs can severely impact human rights or the environment, and even crime for which they should be held accountable. So both the objectives are insufficiently achieved at the domestic level. MNCs feel adequate the concepts of nationality and elude the grip of the unwilling or unable national legislator. So because of the nationality aspect of MNC, the domestic legislations feel adequate or felt inadequate. But if we turn to international law, it has encountered difficulties as well. So there were difficulties in international law as well as national law to regulate MNCs. So lengthy debates about the international legal subjectivity of MNCs have precluded involvement with the substantive question of the right and obligations of companies under international law. So subjectivity has been used as a threshold, awaiting the positive granting of right and obligations by states. Therefore, this cannot, however, hide the fact that MNCs already enjoy considerable right under international investment law and under international human rights law. Therefore, they can ensure protection of their assets before domestic court and through arbitration process, and can claim violation of their right under or before European Court of Human Rights. Ultimately, MNCs do not have binding obligation under international law. Most importantly, they are not bound by international human rights, notwithstanding a range of initiatives attempting to create both voluntary and non-voluntary instruments. At most, they bear certain responsibilities not to harm human rights, but implementation and enforcement depend on the respective government authorities. So again, the question comes to the morality, comes to the natural law. So MNC, whether on their own, act morally, act legally or not. Otherwise, the jurisdiction is conferred with the respective nations. So with this, we can conclude that though MNCs are having role to play in the development of the country or in the development of international law, however, they cannot be recognized as an express subject of international law.